So, Bill, again, thanks for joining me.
It is a climate emergency. We have to act quickly. And the only thing that's going to turn off the feedbacks is basically lowering the temperature. The only way to lower the temperature is to stop putting heat-trapping gases in the atmosphere and find more ways to take them out. And you hear a lot of talk about planting trees and technologies that will do this. And I'm sure those are all good things to do, but they won't make much of a difference in the next 30 years when we really have to get hold of this problem and bring it to heel. And so I've been working with colleagues who work on the carbon cycle of forests and colleagues who work on the carbon cycle of wetlands. And those are doing this remarkable thing. I mean, if you look at the amount of carbon dioxide we emit from everything we do, burning all of our fossil fuels, driving with oil and heating with coal and electricity and everything. And then you look at the amount that we do from, we put in the atmosphere from clearing forests and degrading wetlands, which release a huge amount of carbon dioxide that took thousands of years to accumulate. Mm-hmm. That's about 11 billion tons a year that the world is putting out. Mm-hmm. Remarkably, the increase in the atmosphere every year is less than half that. It's 4.9 billion tons.
Where's it all going?
What?
Where's all that excess going then?
Well, yeah, where is it going? Well, you know, about a bit more than half of it is going into plants on land, like forests, and into plants in wetlands and being stored in soils. And the other sort of 40 or 45% of it is being absorbed by the oceans. Well, that's not so, that's great in terms of climate, but it's terrible for the oceans because when you dissolve carbon dioxide in the ocean, it makes it acidic. Acidic oceans are not as productive. In fact, they're destroying coral reefs, they're destroying anything that has a shell, and the problem gets worse and worse and worse. So the sooner we can increase the uptake of carbon and the accumulation of that carbon in plants and soils, the better off we are in the oceans and in the atmosphere. We begin to turn things around rapidly. If we do it simultaneously while reducing our emissions, we can get to this goal in the time frame that we need. And you know, the alternative is not to get there, in which case then it is a kind of a hopeless situation. But I don't think it is hopeless in principle. I don't think it's hopeless in terms of what we can convince people to do. But we've had a bad run of poor leadership at the political level. And you know, we could add up the extra amount of that has occurred. Although ironically, our US emissions have come down a little bit in the last few years. And it has nothing to do with public policy. It all has to do with economics, that coal is more expensive than solar generated electricity. So coal plants are being shut down. An existing coal plant is more expensive electricity than does a new solar panel plant. So we've aligned the economics with the climate solutions. And you know, when we built our house, I discovered that one out of every 700 panels in Massachusetts was on my house at that year in 2000.
How many panels do you have?
Oh, we had about I don't know, it was 36 or something like that. But it was it, you know, so I thought that, well, that's interesting. Today, the denominator has grown mightily. I've added a few, but you know, we have a much smaller fraction than that now, which is really a good thing.
Good. So go to other interventions.
Going beyond that, I mean, one of the things we've discovered in terms of what are called natural climate solutions, it is to, first of all, protect the accumulated carbon that we have in forests and in soils and in wetlands and in grasslands, and then it occurred to me a few years ago, what if we could increase that? What if we could increase those rates? And then a bunch of research began to show that we could be storing twice as much carbon in our forests as we do. And the reason we don't is because of the way we manage them. We manage forests to keep them young. And young little trees, we now know, don't hold much carbon. And I began looking into this and working with a colleague who measures trees. And we discovered that so there are some remnants even here in New England that's been, we've been cutting down trees in New England now for 400 years, ever since the Pilgrims arrived on at Plymouth Rock. And lo and behold, there are still some older trees. A few of them are pre-settlement from the Europeans. And so we can see what happens if you let them keep growing. And what we've discovered is, for example, in this one set of measurements we did, we found this grove of close, 160 to 200 year old white pines. So that doesn't go back to the beginning, but they're reasonably old trees. They're still putting on carbon. He's been measuring some of these trees since 1992. They get taller, and more importantly, they get bigger around. And
they actually put on carbon by the cube of.
Oh, that's right. Of the measurement.
The diameter of the trunk, you've got the cross section, which is squared, and then you've got the height or the bulk,
which is linear,
which is proportional to the cube.
Yep. And so a very small increment in the diameter, or the radius, if you prefer, pi r squared. There it is. It's growing rapidly. Even if it's a thin shell of a cylinder, it's a lot of carbon. And then if it goes up 170 feet, like some of these older trees do, and that's all growing by this quarter of an inch or whatever it is, it adds up to a lot of carbon every year. So we measured trees, stands of these trees at different ages in forests here in Western Massachusetts. And what we discovered is we said, well, we hear all the time, well, we're managing our forests sustainably. So we never cut more than grows in a year, so that's fine. The problem with that is we don't need to be keeping it constant. We need to be increasing it. Right? If we really want to address this problem, we have to have trees growing more, adding more carbon. By the way, half of the weight of wood is carbon.
Mm.
So just to keep that in mind, it varies a little bit from species to species.
I got it.
Sort of plus or minus 2 or 3% from half.
Mm.
That's in the trunk of the tree, which we all see. It's in the branches, and it's in the roots that we don't see. And in many trees, the amount that's in the branches and the roots adds about 30% to what's in the trunk. And when we harvest a tree, we often just can't use, the branches don't make good boards. The roots are never harvested. They're left to either decay or they're taken to the mill and they're burned for energy. And that releases carbon dioxide right away. And then you have to cut the tree. It's a round tree, and you want a square piece to work with. So you shave off those side pieces. So you have the wooden slabs that go. So seldom is the amount of carbon that's in the wood that goes into building things as much as half of the wood that was in the standing tree. And then when you process it and you make sawdust, and you make a product and you cut off the corners and all that kind of thing, it's maybe only 40% of what was originally in the tree ends up in a wood product. Mm. So this argument that we can store a lot of carbon in wood products is simply, we will store, yes, we can, although we did a study that showed in Oregon, since the beginning of forestry, which is 1900, through 2015, so basically 115 years, we asked the question, where is the original carbon that was stored in the trees that were cut over that whole period today? And it turns out, yes, some of it is still in long-lived products like houses, but that was only 19% of the carbon. 65% of the carbon is in the atmosphere as carbon dioxide, and 16% is in landfills, where it will decay and either make carbon dioxide or methane, which are both heat-trapping gases. So it's, we have this huge legacy. I mean, it's something like a quarter or a 30% or something of all the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is from deforestation and land degradation, releasing carbon from the soils. Well, we've got to put stuff that back where it belongs. And the way to do that is basically to let trees grow. And it's the largest trees that store the most carbon.
So let them grow.
Let them grow. And we gave that a name because we hear about deforestation, which is cutting down forests. We hear about reforestation, which is replanting forests. And we hear about afforestation, which is planting trees where they weren't growing before. But there was no name for letting trees grow. And so we coined the term proforestation, which means, because forestation means to grow forests. And so proforestation is in favor of growing forests. and it turns out,
simple enough.
Study after study shows, again, we just did one in Oregon where we have all the data. In six national forests, only 3% of the trees are bigger than 21 inches in diameter. And the Forest Service has not been harvesting those. They want to harvest those now. So somebody measured something like 600,000 trees, and they found that the five species that would be harvested that were over 21 inches in diameter only accounted for 3% of the trees, but they held 42% of the carbon. And if you looked at the trees that were more than 30 inches, in other words, the biggest of those 21 inch plus trees, they were only 0.6% of the trees, but they held 19% of the carbon. So it's a disproportionate amount in the biggest trees. So we need to protect those and then let the next generation of trees become big trees. That's how we're going to get there.
That's too abstract. You said we need to protect those. I want you to spell it out. What is, who is the we, and how do we protect those?
Okay. I would say we, the public, the American public, should insist that the forests that are storing the most carbon and will store the most carbon in the coming decades should be designated as carbon reserves. And in doing so, we get a lot of other benefits. We get more biological diversity. We get more water management. We get less runoff. We get less soil erosion. We get all kinds of additional benefits from having these large forests filled with large trees.
So you just generated a very interesting concept in my mind. We have strategic petroleum reserve.
Yes.
We don't have a strategic forest reserve.
That's right.
So why don't we make a meme out of that and then promote that and actually get people going down?
Here's the other thing is there are a lot of private forest landowners. Less than half of them actually own those forests for the purpose of producing wood and revenues. They make very little money off of it. It would be possible to pay those people who do not want to cut their trees a small fee every year to keep their trees growing. And what's the amount? Well, it don't have to be just 1 cent more than what they would get for cutting it down. The return on that over the whatever it is 50 years it'll take to grow the forest back. And so it's probably the least costly thing we can do other than energy efficiency in our homes, that is increasing the, you know, the changing light bulbs, the insulating our homes.
Double paned windows, the insulation in the attic, yes.
All yeah, that. Right. And so it's in that category of cost.
Yeah.
So
Wait. It's in that category of investments because you made a very important distinction earlier.
That's right.
It's an investment. It's cost when in fact they should be thinking of it as investment because they buy these worthless pieces of paper that are no longer even pieces of paper, stocks.
Yes.
And they never even see the stocks. They just say, buy me 100 shares of whatever. They never see the stuff.
Right.
And that's an investment. That's important. They'll spend $10,000 for those 100 imaginary pieces of paper, but they won't pay for the insulation in their attic because it's
a cost, not an investment. Right. And it's an investment because you don't spend that money on heating oil or natural gas or electricity or whatever you use. And that money adds to your bank account and you don't have to pay taxes on that increase. Saving money is not taxable, right? So I think important to understand that there are these multiple levels at which we can act. And what is interesting is right now, there are more corporations that are going 100% renewable energy than there are governments. And they're doing it for economic reasons and hey, it looks good, why not? It becomes the most economical thing to do. And more people are doing this, but we keep seeing barriers put up by state governments, local governments. I learned this living in Germany, the installation cost of solar panels in Germany is half of what it is in the United States.
Mm.
And a lot of that is because of the process costs that are put in place in order to discourage this from happening.
What do you mean the process costs? Like what?
Getting permits. The cost of permits is ridiculous in most communities. The rules, the number of community associations that don't allow solar panels because they don't like the way they look. It goes on and on. It may be more important how you feel than how it looks on your house in terms of the future of climate change and the consequences, the weather consequences, which we're all experiencing.
What fools we mortals be. So Bill, I think it's somewhat appropriate and ironic at the same time that your professional activities have gone from being for the Woods Hole Research Center to the Woodwell Climate Research Center. And that was named after Dr. Woodwell. And here we've spent most of our time talking about wood solutions, wood-related solutions. And as you pointed out, truth stranger than fiction. If you had to pick a name for a scientist in a novel and we were writing a screenplay, people would not believe Woodwell.
I think that's right.
Obvious,
but he's a remarkably believable person and has been at the forefront. Even though he's now in his 90s now, he's still at the forefront of thinking about these issues and contributing. And so I take that as an inspiration that I will keep doing this as long as I can.
And as will I, although I don't think I'll make it to my 90s with the current medical challenges I've got. Okay, well, thank you very much today for all your time. And we'll be communicating by email and Zoom and we'll be in touch.
Okay, thank you. All right. Care.